Hello YouTube. Well, here we are. One of the things I've got to do this weekend is take a look at this laptop. The owner's given me permission to film what I'm doing and check it up on YouTube, so let's get some light on the matter. Laptops themselves are great, especially if you haven't got enough room in your home to set up a dedicated PC. I mean, you can just fold them away and they don't take up much room. But if an accident befalls them, it's a lot more difficult to repair them. And that's what's happened here. An accident happened with the power in. It went over on its side and it's caused quite a bit of damage. I'm really possibly the last stop for this laptop before it hits the trash, because a few people have seen it already and they've declared it a no fix. One of the other things that the owners have given me permission to do is, if the fix is ugly, if I've got to run mains wires out of here in order to connect another way, they said fine, anything so long as it can get it running. I'm not sure if we're actually going to be able to get it running after a quick look at the outside. This is a new transformer, so that's sorted. The principal thing is to try and get a charge in the battery and to get the battery to hold that charge. Now, I've already tried to get the CD-ROM out of here in order to give me a bit more easy working space, and there's normally a release somewhere to take the CD-DVD drive out, but not in this case. It looks like it's stuck in the machine. The other people who have looked at it have left it with only about three screws. So let's see if I can get those out. There's one there, and this is completely the wrong tool for the job. I need a cross. A decent crosshead, that looks like one. So basically, first things first is to try and get the cover off, which probably won't be difficult, I hope. Let's just get that screw out of there. Come on. Drat, I've dropped it, but fortunately I've seen exactly where it's gone. Because this office is still in a bit of a mess, you understand. Right, dink, that's one safe. It's still in a bit of a mess because I've still got all the train stuff around here. So the floor the floor is a little on the difficult side. That's chewed out. What else have we got to deal with here? There's one there, which I think is a cover. There's one in here, I think. Yep, there's one in here, there's one in there. There's one in there. There's missing there. Missing there. Etc. etc. Okay, what I'm going to do is get these screws out, get them safe, get the cover off, and we'll come back to it in a moment. Right, here we are with most of the main screws actually off. Most of them were underneath the unit, but one of them is right there. And to do that, we actually had to take the keyboard off. Here's the keyboard, and it has a simple ribbon connection at the back, which leads it into here. And as you can see, it sort of sits like that and then goes back in. So to get it out, you actually have to do the reverse. And to get at it, the easiest way is to use a paper clip and bend it at the end. So what you can then do, if I can just bring this in front of the camera, what you can then do is just dig that in, twist it, and you should be able to lift the keyboard out. And there's about four retention clips, and you just pull it out of the clips, disconnect it, and away it goes. So there's a few more of these lift connections, as they're sort of termed. I'll just zoom you in on one of them, and hopefully that will zoom in and focus. Hello, computer. On the keyboard one, on the one for the keyboard. Yep, it's coming into focus now. And what that is you'll see that the ribbon cable actually sits in here, and this actually lifts up. So you sit the ribbon cable in. Then that goes down and then clasps the ribbon cable in place. There's actually five of them in total on this motherboard that I can easily see at this moment in time. One of them is here. Let's get something that's a little easier to point with. One of them is here. We've got another one here for the main keyboard. Two more here, which are presumably for the mouse pad, and another one here. Not 100% sure what that's for yet. But with these disconnected and that screw undone, I should be able to get the majority of this lifted off and have a look underneath. Yeah, we'll see what we see. Some of the manufacturers will put the socket actually as part of the motherboard, but we're lucky here in that it's actually separate with a bit of cable, and that this corner, which took the majority of the impact, is actually away from the motherboard. The motherboard is tighter on the other side of the laptop. So the key thing now is going to be to hook up the power supply and see if we actually get any power through to this plug. If we don't, then this is probably likely to be the fault. If we do, and the voltage coming across is actually correct to the plug, then we're going to have a problem, because that will mean that the issue is actually on the motherboard. Underneath this section here, there's actually a collection of capacitors. A brief look from the side doesn't seem to show anything to be of issue, and a look at the motherboard doesn't reveal any obvious cracks or trauma to the motherboard, but that isn't to say that something's gone pop. So yeah, that's the next place to look. Well, it was like this, Gav. There was this popping sound and a small wisp of smoke. Yeah, if the laptop wasn't dead before now, it's definitely in need of some component TLC, because it looks like a capacitor's blown. Now, originally I thought that the fault might have been down to this, which is an adapter, because rather than the original HP Pavilion adapter, it was replaced with this, which is a generic multi-voltage adapter. And I've got a feeling it might actually been at the wrong voltage, because, that would explain be one explanation behind the pop. But certainly on this adapter here, which goes, it's supposed to go on the end of there and allow a connection to the Pavilion, I wasn't getting a continuity check on it. I wasn't getting any voltage out the end of it, which led me to have to discard that and go ahead, which meant actually splicing into the mains. Mains? into the internal power. I had to cut it from, you know, the socket that's in here is covered with such glue that not even a craft knife could cut its way through it. I stood no chance of cutting that out of the machine. So I had to work out the pinouts, and the two red, you know, you've got multiple colours here. You've got two reds, you've got a brown. The two reds look to be positive, the brown look to be negative, and you've got two blacks, a cream and a white, which seemed to go nowhere. So I wired it in according to that, which was how the socket was wired in. It took a needle actually to get it in the socket, in the end of the socket, to find out what it actually mapped to. But it could either be the wrong connections, because this did actually seem to, well, I think it must have inverted it or something. I don't know. I can't tell for certain. But certainly I know where the positive and negative was on here. But there's definitely been, it was either over voltage or I've put the voltage down the wrong cables, because it won't pop. So it's definitely in need of some sort of capacitor replacement in there somewhere. I don't know. But I think the main problem was that the voltage wasn't actually getting to the laptop in the first place. I've got a feeling that was the problem. I don't know about the wiring of the socket that was in there, because this had been worked on before. All I could do was follow what had been done before. So the net result is this laptop is definitely deceased a month ago, and I've got to go back to the owner and find out what they want to do about it. Eesh. It's frustrating, principally because I've got a feeling that the power supply wasn't right. I've got a feeling that the power supply was probably over voltage. It's a multi-selectable thing. I do tend to stick with the manufacturer's supplies whenever I can, because there's specific matches of voltage and amperage. And, well, I just don't know what happened, really. But, yeah, it's gone pop. And it's... I absolutely hate it when I don't manage to work something out like this and something else goes wrong and actually adds to the woes of the machine rather than solving them out, even though we are a bit further forward in the diagnostics of what actually was going wrong with it, I think. But there's actually no guarantee that if I had got that and that had been feeding voltage through, that the system would have worked. I mean, there's no guarantees with something like this. And to be honest, they did say to try what I needed because they regarded the system as dead anyway. So, sadly, this one didn't work out, but you can't win them all. Catch you in the next video, YouTube. Take care. Bye.